All right. Good evening, everybody. Thank you all for coming down tonight. We are live from Books and Books in Coral Gables, Florida. So a note to our internet audience watching at home, if at any time during the presentation you'd like to purchase a copy of tonight's book, you could just call the number on your screen. We will take care of that for you. We will get the book signed and we will ship it to wherever you are in the United States free of charge. Also a note to you Books and Books fans out there, we have a new location in the Carnival Tower of the Adrienne Arsht Center for the Performing Arts downtown. We have a beautiful new restaurant and bookstore there, so please check out Books and Books at the Arsht. This evening, Books and Books is very happy to present Ms. Sarah Bladel and her new novel, The Forgotten Girls. And we have a special guest introducer this evening. He is a big fan of Ms. Bladel's. He's a New York Times bestselling author and a great friend of Books and Books. Please welcome to the microphone, Mr. Brad Meltzer.
So, when you realize what Sarah's been doing, you're going to hate her. So, and I say this with only love, and I want to tell you, I met Sarah actually over a year ago at Book Expo. And of course, you really hate her because she's one of the nicest people around. But I asked the publicist, I said, I want you to give me three things about Sarah. And then we're going to ask Sarah three things about herself and see if what Sarah says about herself matches what the publicist would say. So, and this is why, literally, ready for this? So you think this is truly the most popular author in Denmark. And I want to ask you, who do you think said that, Sarah or the publicist? The publicist, of course, says she, right? The queen of murder, the queen of death. They make it sound like she's a criminal. But really, the most popular author in all of Denmark, read by, according to the publicist, reaching one-fifth of the Denmark population. One-fifth of Americans don't brush their teeth, okay? And one-fifth of Denmark is reading Sarah. The other thing is she started her own small publishing house to translate American crime fiction into Danish, which I love, right? Helping out other authors and bringing us to them. So you got to hate her for that because now we know she's nice. And one of the things that I also read, tell me if she said this or the publicist said this, that she plots her books on what she calls a killing wall. And so she knows who she's going to kill and sees what happens. But most important, that she also will take people and take photos of them, like yourselves, and then will kill you when she wants to. Now, who do you think told me that one? Publicist or her? No, publicist does, right? Publicist does. And I appreciate that because I am someone who absolutely, when I see someone who looks like they're worthy of killing, I will kill you. I always do that. The things that she said about herself are actually far more fun than the braggy things that any publicist is going to give you. Is one, that she has a motorcycle license and she loves to ride fast. That she's much more into beer and bones than red wine and foie gras. And she once crossed Iceland on a horse, which is just the coolest thing ever, right? I mean, I went to the Aventura Mall in a car. She crossed Iceland on a horse. But the nicest thing I can say about her is that she's truly a nice person. Sarah is making a tour right now, really across the great American bookstores. And she saw my friend Karen Slaughter yesterday in Atlanta. She's making her way to Sarah Paretsky tomorrow, my friend there in Chicago, and then to my pal Michael Connolly in California, going through Houston and seeing all the different authors. And the reason all of us are coming out for Sarah, it's not just because she's a nice person, which it is. If she was a jerk, none of us would come out. But she's a great writer. And I think when the American audience realizes that there's only going to be more and more people who are Sarah fans in this country, and I'm proud to call myself one of them. So with nothing else said, let me introduce Sarah Bladel.
Wow, what an introduction. Can I live up to that? I'm not sure, but thank you so much, Brad. Actually, when I came in here, I was thinking, wow, a real bookstore with books, not just the paper and school things, a real bookstore? We're not that used to, are we used to that in Denmark? Not that much, right? No, so it's very wonderful to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me. And it's true, actually, years back, before any crime wave in Scandinavia, everybody now is talking about the big wave of Scandinavian crime fiction. And they say, what is it about you and crime fiction in Scandinavia? I think, what is it about American crime fiction? Because we're used to that, and it's actually, it's really true. It's 25 years ago, almost, I think, before anything went so popular. I had a small publishing house in Denmark publishing crime fiction, translated crime fiction. And I was actually traveling around Denmark, visiting 400 booksellers twice a year, bringing my small translated paperbacks and say, please, would you like to buy it? It's a crime fiction, it's really good. And they just look at me and say, are you driving around here to try to sell this? Okay, we take two. And that was just to be nice to me, because it wasn't anything. At that time, crime fiction was actually something you had on your under your night table. It wasn't something that you were proud to be reading. But that's changed now. And some of the booksellers said to me now, Sarah, why didn't you just publish your own book now? Because now we have it in tons of your books. And I said, I never planned to be a crime fiction writer. At that time, it wasn't a dream. It wasn't in my plans at all, because I had such a big joy reading crime fiction. I've always read a lot of crime fiction since I was a kid, actually. Not that rough crime fiction, but The Famous Five. Do you know that? Einar Blyton, just crime, mysteries for children. And that was the way I came into this mysteries. And the good thing for me is that there is a plot in crime fiction. There is something we have to solve. A mystery, there can be a murder, some people can be missing, we have to find them. And that's just a really good drive for me when I'm reading it. And the idea for my first crime novel, it wasn't ever meant to be a crime novel. Actually, now we're not that many people, so I can say that, hey, live streaming. But I had a job where I was so busy, I was a TV producer. And people were yelling and shouting all the time, deadlines, deadlines, deadlines. And then suddenly an idea came to me, and I was thinking, what if a journalist got a story that is dangerous for him, sorry, thank you. Good to have Danes in the audience, thank you. So he will get killed. And that story started up growing in my head. So every time when people were yelling and shouting at the TV production company, I was just shutting down. I didn't close my eyes, but I was just starting telling myself the story. Ah, it could be because he was reading. Now he was, because he was writing an article that is so dangerous, so he'll get killed. But what could it be? Could it be prostitution? Could it be drugs? What could it be? And for, I think, several months, actually, it was just me telling myself a story. And then at the time, I was so curious. So I contacted the homicide department in Copenhagen, asking them, what if I was writing a crime story going on in your department? How would it be, actually? Where do you have your lunch? Where do you pack your car? How is it to work in your place? And what I didn't expect, and I haven't actually really thought it over for real, because what I didn't expect was that actually the chef for the homicide department, he called me the early next morning and said, why don't you come in for coffee? And for that time, at that time, it changed. For being just a thing going on in my head to being real research for a book. And I was scared to death, actually, because I was, can I do that? I'm a journalist, and I've been writing as a journalist for years. And in all these years, I'd actually try to stick very close to what people told me, to write the interviews, to do the reports, to all that thing, very close to some fiction that was totally new for me. It was going into really deep water, because Louisa Rigg, who is my main character, she was very clear to me from the beginning. I saw her, I know how she react, I could feel how she would do in this and these cases. And I thought that she was what you will call a tough cookie. She was professional, she was very dedicated for her job. And when I had the first experience putting her into my fiction, I started up, and then it's actually she on the first, I think, 20 pages in the book, she had a breakdown. Very bad start, actually, for a superhero, isn't it? She's not a superhero. She was. She had a flashback for the first time. She had to go out to a young girl and tell her that her boyfriend was attacked on the street and actually he was killed. And all the emotions came to her. And I know at that time, that was the first time that I had the feeling that my character was so much alive. So actually, she took over. I was just a machine. I was just the one who's typing. She was the one out in the field. But I didn't I thought that I created a tough woman who didn't have all the emotions inside her. But she had. And then, of course, I could just have deleted it all. But I didn't, because I had the feeling that that is the way she is. That is Louise Rick, and then we have to work on it. And now I've been working on it for 9 books, and it's much better now. She don't break down in every book. But that was how she came to me. She is so much herself, and I think it's because she was so clear for me when I met her at the first time. The Forgotten Girls is actually the first book in a trilogy where I have moved her from the homicide department to a special search unit for missing people. And when I did that, after have been written 6 books, it was because it opened up for so many more cases. Not just, if you can say that, not just murder cases, but I could, for example, take her out of Copenhagen, which is really nice sometimes, and put her back to the place where she grew up, read, I grew up, in Valsø. It's a 40-minute drive from Copenhagen. And the first thought I had about The Forgotten Girls was that I grew up very close to a forest, totally up in front of the forest. And in the forest there was a mental hospital. And at that time, 25 years ago, maybe even more, 35 years ago, when we were in the forest, then we met some of the kids who actually was, at that time I didn't know that they were put away in that mental hospital. But we met them in the forest, and now I know it's totally political incorrect and say, we said, oh, it is the Gaga. You know, we were kids at that time, and we didn't know that that was so strange, because they were waving at us, and we were waving at them. We knew that they were different. We knew that they were, at that time, it was okay to say retarded. It's not okay anymore, but you know what I mean. And it was just some of the people that we met when we were out in the forest. It wasn't that strange. They were part of the community. And suddenly, when I started doing my research for The Forgotten Girls, I read an article about young kids children who were put away because they had a mental disease. And sometimes people, the parents, were recommended to forget about them and move on with their life. Got new children. We'll take care of your children. It's okay. They are in good hands here. And then the parents didn't visit them anymore. And I thought that was so heartbreaking, because of course then I remember all the kids that we met when we were playing in the forest at that time. And I would start thinking, is that some of the forgotten children that we met? I was never aware of that. And when I read about it, I thought it must be in the 30s, maybe the 40s, not in the 80s. I thought it was something happened way back, but it wasn't. And the next thought for The Forgotten Girls was, what if all my stories start, what if? And then it continues going on. And what if you find a body of a lady around a woman around 50? 49, 48. And it's very hard to identify her. You don't know who it is. Nobody has been missed. Nobody has reported missing. So the police ended up putting a picture in the newspaper. And they got a tip. Maybe it could be someone actually way back who was put into a mental hospital. because she had a scarf. She had a scar on her face. And the woman who gave the tip said, I recognize the scarf. And then Louise Rick, who is the leader of the special search unit, she drove down to that old mental institution, which is now a daycare center. It's very typical for these huge buildings. Now it's used for something else, very, very much nicer. And she found out, she found the old files. And it was right, she was actually put there years back. But the fact is that she was reported dead 31 years ago. So how could that happen that she just found the body now? And very often for me, it starts like that. It is, what if that is happening? And how? What for all these years? What have gone on for all these years? And in the files at the mental hospital, they found out that not only that she died 31 years ago, but she actually had a twin sister. And she was reported dead the same day. They died with few minutes between them. And now the case is, if she had been alive for these many years, what about a twin? Is she still out there? And that is the much that I can say about the Forgotten Girls without saying too much. But that is always, for me, no, that's the main story in the Forgotten Girls, of course, what happened way back, what happened now. And this story at the same time take Louise Rick back to Valsø. It's a small city where I grew up myself. And she is confronted with things she had actually put behind her and have hoped that she has left behind her, but it all comes up to her now. And then it will be difficult for me to say any more without saying too much. But I'm very open for questions. If anybody has some questions, for example, how do you say Valsø in American? I don't know, Valsø?
First question, it's always tough. Here we go.
Yes, Matt.
I know what it's like on the other side of that, right?
I wonder, now that you've been here, you think about bringing her, Louise, to the United States?
That was just because then I got the chance to travel around more. Actually, in my books, there is another main character, not the main character as Louise, but very close to, and her name is Camilla Lind. She's a journalist. And in 2008, I was doing a road trip with my son here, driving around down the West Coast. And I didn't plan to use that in the book. But then Camilla Lind is a journalist. And just to explain shortly, I have her in my books, not just because I use her as a show off to show how great a journalist I was myself, but because I think it's great to have a murder case or a police case or whatever it is and show it for both angles, the police and the journalist. So I used her very much for that in my books. And sometimes, I admit, sometimes I push her to the edge and sometimes a little further. So after one of my earlier books, then I thought that she needed a little rest, so I put her on a road trip. So actually some of my stories is around the West Coast, but not the crime fiction plot. But one thing that she picked up here was a boyfriend. does that work? And there was a journalist in Denmark who said, but what is it about, why do she have to have that very cool, he is a Dane, but he was living in Santa Barbara. Isn't that too much for her? Isn't that too super cool? And I was thinking, you know what? For years and years and years, people, not my readers, but orphans reviewers, they say, what is it? Why can't Camilla Dane and Louise Rick just settle down, have family, raise kids, have a happy life? And I was just like, do you think it's totally for sure that you'll have a happy life if you settle down with the family? What is that? Maybe it's okay not to have a family. Maybe it's very good to have a family. And in many ways, I know it is because I got one myself. But it's not, you know, it's not just, it's like you cannot be happy if you don't have a husband and kids. What's that about? What if you like, actually, you like your job? What if it's okay? So now I've given her a husband, a very wealthy one. I've moved them into a very big manor in the Forgotten Girls. And I do it just for one reason. Take it all away from her again. Sorry, Camilla, that wasn't nice.
Sarah, we know that you write a series featuring Louise Rick.
Did you, before you started writing about Louise, did you have other heroines? And if you had other heroines or heroes in previous books, are they going to make a reappearance in a new title?
No, because actually, I've only written a crime fiction novel with Louise Rick.
Louise.
Yes, exactly. But the fact is, I've just published my book number 9 with her in Denmark. And for now on, that is the I finished the series here so far. Maybe I cannot control these girls. Sometimes if the story gets too good and they show up and they really prove to me you have to write this story, then I have to do it. But so far, it's another setup who's up in my mind, and it's still a female character, but I haven't got the time to figure out if there can be some other heroes or heroines, so it's a little bit too early to say. There is one thing, just the last thing, there's one thing I'm doing when I'm starting a new book. I'm doing a lot of research. And one of the places I always start doing my research is at the Forensic Institute in Copenhagen. And from the very early beginning, I had a forensic forensic, the one who's doing the autopsies. What do you call it, Brad? Exactly. And he helped me very much. And at the Forensic Institute, they start, in my books, he is called Fleming. And the Forensic Institute, they start calling him Fleming. And that turns out with one big problem for me, because he said, okay, if I'm in your books, then I want to know if I will ever have a date with Louise Rick. And that was a big problem, because what if he won't? Will he stop helping me or what? No, it's just for fun. Yeah?
Sure, no problem. When you're introducing the series in the U.S. now, I was wondering if you were thought at any point about certain parts of the series or certain aspects of the story that you thought that an American audience might find, you know, like difficult
strange
to understand,
yeah,
or just like culturally, if you thought about any factors culturally that would be difficult for an American audience to understand, or like,
yeah,
maybe like would be received in a different way.
Yeah, I do understand what you mean, but I don't think so. Of course, we talked about will it be strange with the names, for example, but I've tried one time when I was doing a panel at BoucherCon, a crime fiction convention over here, and they say one of the question was, but why didn't she just shoot them? And you know, that wouldn't happen in Denmark. And they said something else is, but do you have criminal people in Denmark? You're so small a country. What is the biggest crime? I said, oh yeah, we have 2 streets very dangerous to walk in. That can be a little bit difficult to explain. But actually, and I know that's not fun at all, but we had a terror act. Last week. So, you know, everything is moving close. Things actually happened, even that we say, oh no, it will never happen here. But it did. So I think the most, but it's not just for American audience. It's like police procedures around the world is different. Why do we do it like that in Denmark and we do it another way in Japan, for example? So that can be a little bit different, but I think that readers, they know that it can went on in another way, because normally you don't see serial killers in, you know, murdering 20 people in Copenhagen that will be very tough for me to make my readers believe in. And at the same time, big shootings around the street, but we have it actually now. So it's not that strange anymore.
Yeah, I was just curious, when you were a journalist, what kind of reporting did you do, and did that lead into the material you're writing about now?
Not to begin with, actually, but I did a lot of, I've been on a magazine, so I've been doing interviews with every kind of people. And that is, and I've been traveling around the world doing my reportage. And I won't say that I've been doing crime fiction, crime stuff as well. I won't say that I come into my crime fiction novels because of that, but I've been learning a lot about people and a lot about different ways to handle big emotions or sorrow. If people lost a child in an accident or what it can be, they were killed, then the way they handle losing, for example, a child. Where if I was thinking for my own, I have a son, he will turn 18 later this year. I thought to begin with that must be, if somebody, hit him down on the street and killed him that way, I will hate them badly the rest of my life. I will be filled with hate every day. And that is not what I meant, what I was meeting out there when I was interviewing people who actually been in that situation. And that I can use. I can use, when I go 15 years back, I can use all the different way people react and handle big things in their lives. That has been so useful, and has been so useful when I'm building up characters and putting skills into people in my books. So it has been very useful, but not, yes, I've been in court for days and days and days following a special case, but I know how it looks in there. I know that it's very hard to be sitting on these benches all day, but it's not what I really use in my books. It's much more people's stories, life stories.
Yeah. Thanks, Victor. Not familiar with your characters, but some of the things people said got me thinking is, I think when you do your translation or when you supervise your translation, I mean, somebody asked about the American market, but there are a lot of other English language markets out there that sometimes are even bigger, India, for example. Is there one market that they look to translate or give it a pan English translation that works across several territories, such as the UK, United States? And then the other thing is this, I'm not familiar with your characters, but I think there's a survey that mentioned, one of these surveys they come up with to rank places, and that Denmark was the happiest place on earth.
Yes.
And I'm wondering, how does that affect the way your characters think, in your opinion, or does it not, the type of things that they do or their actions?
That is really a good question. Can I start with the happy people? because that is the thing that we often hear. Oh, you're voted to be the most happy people in the world. Are we that? We have two Danes here. I think I got a hard time to see that. That's why we're here. No, maybe that is the reason that I write crime fiction, because we're so super happy all the time. I don't know where they got that from, really, because we have, of course, I think we have a country, it's very easy to live in. We have a very good health system. We have a good care of elder people. We have a very good social system. So if that counts for being happy, yes, we are. But if you are in a long line in the supermarket, people are not over happy all the time, I have to say, or if the buses or metros doesn't come at the right time. People are not more happy than they will be anywhere else. And about the translation, because that is very, very interesting. I know Brett might have a comment for that as well, but I think that it is so difficult. And for the first time, I have a most fantastic editor here at Grand Central, my US publisher. And I've never been in a contract with such a committed editor. He was really going into details. He had so many good questions. We were, you know, it was actually like getting my manuscript back from a Danish editor. And I know my language, what we all know at the time here, is not very perfect. It's not my first language. We can hear that, all of us. And I cannot, you know, go in with all these small details in the editors and correct it. So for the first time, I've never tried that before, I have a book doctor who is a person going in between me and the editor. And, you know, and then I flew over to New York and sat with her for a week and tried to tell her, how does it look like when we are in Velsø? We have pictures. I try to, you know, explain. And that was so much fun for me, because actually I felt that now we're going into the details, so it will be very close to correct, very close to the Danish one. But I don't know, and I know that they will use the same in at the UK market. But you're totally right. I don't know if that will work in India or wherever. But I had a very strange and not too good experience for my German market, actually, because German is a very important market for it's huge market. We are neighbors. It's very good market to be in. And I had a big crowd on the university at Berlin. I was having a speech there. And after there were hundreds of people. After that, a professor came up to me and said, "Sarah, I have to ask you a question. We were talking about, is it you who write so poorly, or is it the translation?" And thank God there was another lady coming up and say, "Oh, I've been reading Sarah's books in Danish. It's not her fault." But that was actually a very, very bad experience, because, you know, I have had German language in school for a couple of years. I'm not strong at that language. I cannot see if it's not good enough. I cannot go into details and see that it's not good enough. So you have to believe in the editors. You have to believe in people. What about the South Korean market, for example? I don't have a chance. Meeting my editor in Budapest, I don't even get it. You know, and that is so difficult. And then you really have to believe your editors and your agents are doing, that your agents have to push to be quite sure that the editors are doing a great job. But you're very much on your own out there. Yeah, good question, thank you.
I had a question for you. When you write the book, how long time does it take you? And what do you do? Do you kind of go on your own and not talk to anybody for a couple of months?
Actually, yes. I'm not very good company when I'm writing. I think that it's difficult to say exactly about the timeline, because normally I will say about a year. I'm doing the research for maybe 3 months, and then maybe a little more when I just start writing. And then I go in my summer house. And at that time, when I have my first, you know, all the way through from A to B, then I'm not good company. And it is not because I'm trying, you know, to be very authors with heads and writing in the night and sleeping in the day and drinking red wine. It's not like that at all. But I get very emotional touched about the people that I'm writing about. I'm trying, before I start a new novel, I'm actually really trying to build up the people, the characters in the book, so I feel that I know them. I don't have to like them, but that I feel that I know them. I have a background story of any of the characters. So when I put them, when we start and I put them into action, then it's like people I actually know. And I involve myself a lot in it, and some of the days when I have a son, Adam, and when he come back from school, some days he just look at me saying nothing, maybe whispering, "Did you kill anybody today, Mom?" I said, "Yes, I did. Sorry." I'm not fun at that time, because actually it is like I've lost a person that I really care about, And then I got over it. Okay, I take a walk and I continue. I'll be myself again. But I can be so discreet, so I forgot where I put my car, for example. I'm not dangerous. I'm hopefully not dangerous for other people when I'm walking around the street. But I'm very much, that is my first, that when I'm writing, you know, my real life is in second line. So I'm trying really to concentrate. And I do that not just because I cannot take it off my shoulders again. I think I'm doing it because I wanna to try to do my best. I think if you're having a success like Red told you about and I'm doing pretty well at that, then I really have to put all I can into it. Do it as good as I can. And for this month that I'm doing my first draft, then I really put myself into it. And when that is over, we'll have a lot of fun because then I can do whatever it takes. And then I have the whole period with my editor and where she said, oh, all these bad words you put in, can we take them out? You swore a lot. We have to take it out. It's not nice in print. And that is a totally different period in the process. And then we have the release thing, and then it's out smiling. And in a minute, I will be back again with the curtains down. And I just, it's a wonderful thing because it shifts a lot. Yeah.
Do you have more characters? Like, is your mind always working? Do you have like a lot of stories and you write it down, all your concepts, and then you're going to go back to them?
Actually, yes. No, but you know, I've also been in that situation that I was feeling and thinking, okay, that was it. Nothing more showed up. I'm finished. I cannot force myself to develop characters. I cannot force myself to develop a plot. I can pick up things, like you said. Sometimes I think that was on my second novel. I had it's about internet dating, and I have come rough at that rapist. I have really drawn the lines bad up for him, and there was something that didn't work for me. And then I was out one night having a beer with a friend, and suddenly I saw him standing in the bar as we were talking about. I said, "Oh, there he is. That is his profile and the way he talked to the lady. He's a real charming guy. He's so gentle. He buys her drinks." And I say, "There he is. He is the cruelest man I ever known." And you know, sometimes it just feels right when you see it. Then you see, oh, that is exactly how he looks. So I pick people. I pick them up. It's not, and then I can put them together. It's not that they look exactly like, you know, one I've been working with, but it's small traits that I can put together and say, oh, that is exactly how he looks.
So you have a lot of novels, and there are other authors that have a lot of novels that sometimes turn into movies. Have you thought about that or been approached?
I have. I think I have my film option sold several times for so many years, and sometimes now we just take it all back because you know what? I'm in that fantastic privileged situation, so I don't think that it will change a lot for my sales in Denmark if it was a series or not. But I think it could be very fun, fantastic, brilliant if it turns out the right way. But if it turns out the wrong way, then I'd rather not have any film or TV series. In Denmark, we are very good at making TV series. I think we have very huge successes around the world with some of the TV series, and they're great people. What you don't see is when it went wrong, because of course a lot of it is very good, but some of it is not good. So I wait. Yeah, I wait until it feels right. I've been in the situation, so we have manuscript for several of the books, and you know, I always had the feeling that it doesn't feel right. Why do you have to put Louise in that situation? Actually, I try very hard to do my research good. I try to put her in a specific way to be. You don't make a laugh of her. Don't make her like a chick lit. Please don't. I don't want that. But maybe now that I've entered the Syrian, if the check is big enough, then I don't care anymore. No, that was for fun. I didn't mean that.
Any other questions? Does that have one, Brett? Andres.
I think I have a partial answer for Kayvon's question about the happy people. I went to Copenhagen last summer.
Okay.
And I was very impressed in our hotel. The front desk had a bar. Yeah. And there was a sign that said, "We regret we cannot sell alcohol before 10 a.m. And I said, okay, these people are serious.
Oh, is that good or bad for us? I don't know.
But I did want to risk the question that you dismissed at the outset. What is it about Scandinavian crime fiction? I mean, what these countries that have a reputation for being these ideal societies in some way, and yet they're producing this very dark sort of work.
Maybe, yeah, the pictures. I think that it's like so many other things. When people have success with something, then more come into it and want to try it as well. But maybe it is because we don't have that much crime in real life in Scandinavia that we have. If there was shooting all the time, if people were killed in the streets all the time, maybe we were writing love fiction instead. So maybe it's because it's not like, a daily thing we had there. But I think that the Scandinavian crime fiction wave, or what you will call it, is because we mix a little more person, but that's not a fact anymore. But if you turn back 10 years maybe, then it could be because we put a little bit more personal stories into our main character's life, and that got women into reading crime fiction. Because actually that was a big change. To begin with, when I was traveling around in Denmark talking about my books, I've met several women came up to me and said, pointing at me and said, I'm not a crime fiction reader. But now I got one of your books and I read every crime fiction novel I can get into. So maybe I think that is one of the things who have actually changed, that we have much more female readers into this fiction. And the only reason that we have that is because they can relate to some of the main characters' things. They, for example, as I said, Louise Rieck, I tried to do her hero, Tough Cookie. That didn't work for me. I didn't have that in me, maybe. But there was, she was just ordinary. She was just normal. She, a lot of women can find something in her life that they can relate to. But at the same time, for me, it was very important, you know, not just to write about picking up children, go to the grocery store, you know, all that, because I am a crime fiction writer. So for me, the plot and the crime fiction story is most important. But if you don't relate in any way to the characters, then you don't give a damn if they are fired. You can just put them into, they can control traffic lights somewhere out in Midtjylland, for example. You have to find a little bit personal things in them that you like or don't like or get curious about, something that you can relate to. Otherwise, fire them, put something new in the job. We don't care. I think that is one of the reasons that we have succeeded with that Scandinavian. But at the same time, that is not a Scandinavian thing anymore, just Scandinavian. You can find that in a lot of crime fiction novels, so it's not typical Scandinavian. But that was the reason that new readers come into that genre, after my opinion.
All right, do we have any more questions or comments for Sarah? No? All right then. A reminder for our internet audience watching at home, there's still time to call the number on your screen. You could purchase a copy of The Forgotten Girls. We will get Sarah to sign that for you, and we'll ship it to wherever you are in the U.S. free of charge. Also, a reminder that all of our live-streamed events are archived. So if you don't get a chance to watch them live, or if you just want to watch it more than once, you can go to the Books and Books website, go to the live-streaming link, and any event that we broadcast from here at the store will be saved there for you to watch at your convenience. For those of you here at the house, we have The Forgotten Girls, as well as some of Sarah's previous titles, for sale at the counter over there. She's going to be signing right back here. I want to thank our guest introducer, a great friend of Books and Books, Mr. Brad Meltzer. And this was such a charming presentation. Please give a big hand to Sarah Blader. Thanks very much. Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you so much. Okay. Thank you very much. And thank you so much for showing up on this one.